Right.
We both dressed up. Hey, look, bring lights up. I'll see if I remember anyone. In the old days, I haven't said that. I probably wouldn't remember any of you lot, would I? I used to get up to. I've heard Tony Barbados is here. Tony Barbados is here, right? He's the only person I bought a car off. So I made money out of worth £900 for a brown Jaguar. And someone went into the back of it. I got £1,100 change. So I probably owe you a drink, Tony. You remember Daniel, don't you? Jugamail, etc., etc.
Is that my drink? It's mine.
I haven't drank
a drink since midday.
Same here.
Welcome to the Midland Arts Centre. Welcome to a night with Simon Fowler and myself, Daniel Rachel. We've written a book together.
Absolutely.
Do you recognise him?
Yes, actually.
Has he been lying to? I didn't know that was behind us.
I took that photograph of Simon, and I think it's 1989, so Simon was 20, and that's my bedroom.
Yes, that's all right, yeah. Moving on.
So as you can see, there's a poster of James Dean. I think it's Revolver above, Birmingham City scarf, Madness. I'm not saying whose scarf. A Mangy Bananas poster.
Yeah, you see that? Do anyone remember the Mangy Bananas?
No. They were going to be the big Birmingham hope before I check this in town.
Yeah, I think that was their undertaking.
So, thank you very much for coming, and we're going to be doing this evening over two halves, where Simon and I are going to chat for three quarters, an hour or so. Then there'll be a chance for you to refresh yourselves with whatever your liquid choice is, and then after that brief break, then we'll come back, and if you have some questions for Simon, then this will be your opportunity to ask him. And then Simon's going to do a selection of hits at the end of the Inspiral Carpet, is it? But the reason, as we're going to discover shortly, is in this half, Simon's going to play a small handful of songs that are very special, which we'll come to as we come to them. So, what do you remember of here, the Mac? Did we ever come here?
I don't know. Last time I was here, I was with my folk band, Merrymouth.
Oh.
Hey. 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 Hey.
Yeah.
Everyone fell out.
What, here? On stage?
Yeah, no. That was great, but I think the first time I came here, I was at school, I think I came here, we watched a film called Ice Station Zebra. I think I was at junior school, I was at Olverley Junior School down by the Rover in Alton in Surrey Hill. And came here and, I do remember, yeah, because he was the tearaway kid in that class. His name was Stacey Jones, which I think was funny because it sounded like, you remember Casey Jones? Yeah. He was an absolute toad this way. And he had to stay on the coach. Like, he swore.
What did he say, Villa?
He was always in trouble with Stacey Jones, was, but he's just like a my Hemingway. I always wish that I was in trouble when I was in school, but my dad was a policeman. When your dad comes home with a truncheon and all those things can be brand new.
Handcuffs.
Handcuffs, yeah. Well, he said it was.
And it's a kinky sort.
So yeah, cheddar road.
So you people may or may not know, but Simon and I grew up four doors apart in Alton, Soho. So our friendship was kind of heading for 45, 50 years. And much of what we decided to try and explore in this book is how from our friendship, kind of, our lives develop really, but more particularly your life, of course. But there's lots of coincidences and meetings of people that are going to become very important in Simon's life that we don't know is going to happen at the moment. So you mentioned Alvin Junior School, which is where I went, but more significantly, it's where Steve Craddock went to junior school.
Yeah, you mentioned. He's going to tell you the story, so I'll tell you the story. The two of them are down Oxbow Woods, right, and getting out their willies for Jenny in the White House.
The irony of that story is that it was Jeevan's idea. Oh, thank you very much. Cheers. It's Gillian's idea. She asked us if she'd prove that we were boys.
I think all the kids now have to do that on a daily basis. Which one can go to the box?
But when Steve and I were together, we were about nine, I think, and I wasn't sure what we had to do, and Steve said we have to unzip, and I said all right, and then when I went to do that he ran. Which that's not really Steve's character, is it?
That's it. I have to bring that up with him, so to speak.
But the other extraordinary thing about where we lived, and we'll come to why you end up living where you do in a moment, is that there's I'd say a half a mile radius in which your and my houses are next door to each other. Steve is just, quarter of a mile away, and Damon Minchella, bass player of Ocean Coasting, is within that square, but at that point, nobody knows each other.
That's right, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'll tell you a story about the way this really all happened. It starts off, strangely enough, this story in Cyprus. In 74, I've got to get this geopolitically correct. I think that Turkey invaded Cyprus.
Yeah.
So, the people who run Wheeler and Acon screen at this point, a place called Victoria Road, on the corner was a dolphin pub. Does anyone know that area? Yeah. It's not there anymore, so I think it's now Aldi. Just beyond that is the Dolphin Fish and Chip Shop. And they put a letter through my mum and dad's house, 26 Victoria Road, saying, could we buy your house? The reason was because their family had become refugees. And they come over here. So, I remember going down to our hall because I thought I'm going to lose my friends at school. Crying. Because when you're nine, you make new friends at school, well, a couple of months, so it doesn't really matter. So we were just going to move to a house which was not the house that we lived in. Otherwise, I would not have got to know Dan. I wouldn't have met Damon. I wouldn't have met Steve, and most important to me, I wouldn't have met Robert, my partner, who was Daniel's best friend at school. Anyway, that house fell through at the 11th hour, and I remember my mum crying then, because we was going to move to a house about half a mile up the road from where we were, and my life would have been completely different. I'd probably have been married with five children. The editor of the Sunday Times, perhaps, nice house on Richmond Hill, and he
ruined.
That's how we met. Really, and everything else. Jesus Christ, what a sort of a butterfly flies, flaps its wing. You know, someone in Australia gets diarrhea. Isn't that the same?
It isn't, it should be that. Yeah. So let's introduce the first of the songs you're going to do in this half. And when Simon was 20, he made a cassette in his bedroom with an acoustic guitar like this, playing into a tape recorder.
Well, it wasn't quite like that, actually, I must say, 20.
And he just, he made a complete cassette of about 60 minutes of all the songs he had written at that point to give to my mum, in fact, who had taken a shine to you. And we recently discovered that cassette, and some of you may have the 7-inch single that came with various editions of this book. Does anybody have those singles? Yeah. So two of those tracks that you have, I, which became Fox's Folk Face, is that what it's called? Mm. And An American Way of Life came from those sessions. But what I think you should play now is Dreamer, because it might give a feeling of where your head was at and your style of songwriting was when you were in your teens. So should we hear it first, and you can talk about it after, unless you want to introduce it.
I'm trying to think if you should say that. I mean, I kind of learned to do this really with my father, because he was a copper, but really I think he always wanted to be a singer. Hmm. He's a consummate show-off as well. I mean, you can see I took after my mum. And I remember we got a book of, incidentally, Mr. Sandman got a book of,
oh, Jesus.
I'm not very good at technology.
That's all on me first, that's Frank Spencer. Of course, being Frank Spencer and Karl Marx, you set up a Superman. Yeah, I mean, maybe that's right, actually. Because I got a lot of that, the first time I started to learn how to play, and I got this book, and I sang these songs with my father, and they were basically the crossed English folk songs and the old American sort of 30s, Gershwin and Irving Berlin and Cole Porter, all those sort of grand songs. So maybe there is a bit of this. Incidentally, I've just been knocking this one up backstage, if that's a... I'll think next time we do that, I'll come up with a different script. Sounds a bit, yeah. Also, I think that, I think looking back at it, I must have played this when I recorded it with a capo, because either my voice, and then my voice broke quite late, but it can't have been an octave higher than this. So I suspect that I was actually playing with a capo. So I'll go into my Roy Orbison range. Dream of coming around, waking up, sleepy town. I'm heading for a fall like never before, not to blame. You're looking at me. Dream of what you say. Get me going to the olden days when light used to fall, we'd be on the barn floor of the hay. Dream of what you say. Do you remember the days when we were playing? And those days were so long we could get together, we'd be in love forever and ever. Oh, say I'm young and I'm wrong. Could be more than a song. It's rubbish, that bloke. It's another sort of rubbish. I was 20. This is 17 years. Dropped to 37 years. Dreamer coming round. I don't care if you wake up all the time, cause it all goes down, they'll change. We're not to blame. Dream of what you say. Do you remember the nights when we were playing? And the nights were so long. We could get together, we'd be in love forever and ever. But don't say I'm young and I'm wrong. Keep them on the song. Keep them on the song. Give him more than a song.
Beautiful song. So what would have been going through your head, do you think, if you imagine yourself as a kind of mid-teens heading into your 20s, where you're writing lots and lots of songs, but you're not in a band. And
well, I want to be a football commentator.
Yeah.
I became a journalist. I worked for the Post and Mail. Mainly on the Soil News, which was great for me because it was like about a 5 minute drive up the road. I was with my mum and dad at the time. I wanted to be basically John Watson. That's who I wanted to be. Match of the Day was important to me. I'd grown up loving the Beatles and Simon and Garfunkel and Motown and all the classic things that I still listen to today. But the idea of doing what I do now almost was ludicrous. The idea of being John Watson was daft enough. But I used to. Do you ever used to play Salutia?
Yeah.
My parents could never afford a chopper bike, but I got the Munich Salutia for Christmas 1974. I was just over the moon.
Over the moon.
Over the moon, Brian,
Mars.
So the idea that you made a scale electric, that was my childhood, really. And playing Slam Up the Wall down at Jubilee Park on your bike and see you in the woods.
So this idea that an uncle of yours who worked for the Post and the Mail, who had said, if you go to journalist school and then come out of that and get yourself in a local newspaper, and then that can lead to local radio, yeah, and that leads you to be the next, yeah, John Motson. Yeah. You actually did go to journalist school, didn't you?
Yeah, I was spending a year in Cardiff. I mean, that was what I wanted to do. Within a fortnight of going to the Solihull News, I realised I'd made the biggest mistake of my life. I was cop watching and I realised I didn't want to be told off by short blokes I didn't fancy, balding, probably 10 years younger than I am now, and very good at their jobs. To be fair, so I thought, this is not for me, I thought, it's sod this. So,
but you think you were.
But so I stayed there for maybe 5 years.
But were you writing songs with a kind of a suppressed desire to want to do something else, or with a dream, or with an idea that you might one day could be singing?
No, you sit down and you write a song, you sit down and write a song.
So why were you doing it? Was it just a compulsion, or what?
I don't know, I started writing songs when I was 13. Did you hit this? I mean, you probably wouldn't have done. Oh no, it is, it's on Radio London. Was it his name, Robert Elms?
Yeah.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Is that national?
What?
Radio London.
Well, the name probably is, yeah.
Anyone lived in London recently?
Yeah, National Radio London.
That's why this is not the word, was it? Anyway, I got basically thrown off the show because I said,
"Oh yes."
Oh yeah, I said, "Well, I was talking about songs about 13. They're all nonsense. They're all about being in Colombia, taking cocaine, and having sort of sex with dwarves." Somebody said, "Yes, we don't use that terminology anymore." Went into a piece of music. The music comes out, thank you. Tosser. Dwarf. Tosser.
Yeah. Well, in America they say small people.
Borgs. I bet they're called Borgs.
I did ask some people to say what the terminology was, and they were quite confused that you'd been kicked off for that. This was only a couple of months ago. But, But you weren't, it was a joke, so you weren't joking.
I didn't really write about it. I was actually going to say spastic. What? Stop it!
Well, now we're talking about... Well, now we're talking about controversial areas. When we were selecting the lyrics that were going to this book and what we were talking about, there's a song that, at the time that you wrote called Blackies.
Yeah.
And it turns out that Blackies is a very heartfelt song of anti-racism, of kind of not really understanding why one person will be hated upon by another. But when we then expand the conversation in the book, what I didn't realise was, you know, obviously Oscar Harrison becomes the drummer of Ocean Colosseum.
Yeah.
And he's kind of really your first black friend, and it's
Well, I mean, I grew up initially in Acock Stream, which is sort of white working class and English and a kind of Irish area, really. Then moved up the road to Alton. I didn't have any black pals, to be honest, until... Yeah, probably into Oscar, but...
at the time...
We're going back... I did not grow up in a multicultural area of Britain, but...
But the interesting thing about Oscar is Oscar had been in a reggae band from Birmingham called Echo Bass, who'd been on tour with you before too. And yet, at that point, you were in a band called the Fanatics that was very much kind of Buzzcocks, Velvet Underground inspired. And that seemed an unusual band for Oscar to join.
It was because we had our old manager.
Eddie Lynn.
Yeah, a guy called Eddie Lynn, who managed the Fanatics. He managed the Echo Bass and said, oh, I know what drummer. So, Oscar came down. He started playing drums. Thought, we never have a drummer who can play like him. You're in. So, that's all that's lost. And I think that when we looked to the studio at Bob Lamb's, I mean, it was very multicultural, multi everything thing. He taught me how to smoke. She's meant to be here tonight. Maybe hasn't turned. Oh my God, there he is.
He was just talking about you.
Yeah. Jesus Christ. And the shopkeeper over here. So as I was saying, he taught me about the Bible and the Wii. We'll move on now.
Yeah. So, well, let's play another song. And when looking into research for this book, another thing I found was a videotape that I'd filmed of Simon with an acoustic guitar in the late 80s, early 90s. And one of the songs you did on that videotape was She's Got It. And as I say, Simon was in the Fanatics, which is the band that Oscar joined. And they used to do this song. It was a really great live song, very fast and Buzzcock style. But on this tape, you did it in quite a jazzy style, and it really brought out a kind of a different melody than you would have ever realised.
Yeah, that's I remember doing that. We stayed at a friend's grandma's flat in St. John's Wood.
Somehow she's got it. Does anyone remember the Fanatics?
Did anybody see the Fanatics?
Did you?
I never did.
The Fanatics were pretty big in Birmingham. I mean, you sold out at the Irish Centre, which for a local band was going.
The strange thing was is that in Birmingham them days, is that basically you got the Barrel, which became the Dubliner. You got the. We never played that. You got the Hibernian up in. We never played there, and then basically from the Barrel Organ, the next stop was the Irish Centre, and then the next stop, because the Hummingbird was shut at that point, the next stop was the MEC.
Where the Fanatics supported the Alarm.
No, that was at the
Aston Villa Leisure Centre. Yeah,
Freudian slip. Freudian slip. So really, it was a very, very small village, Birmingham was. That's why all the people in bands got to know one another.
Yeah.
And then really, me, Steve, Damon and Oscar, basically were the last four standing of all the bands that we ever met. And everyone went off and worked either at W.H. Smith's or at NatWest or gone to college or...
Well, just before you play She's Good. So, the big local journalist, I don't know if he still is, was Mike Davis, who was the editor of Brumbeat. And Mike Davis went to see the Fanatics many times, but he famously said that he now knows what it was like to have seen the Beatles play at the Cavern, having just witnessed the Fanatics play. And he said the only question is, not are they going to make it, when? And
I think he was sectioned just after.
And I think this is a good illustration, albeit the toned down version, of one of the great songs the band used to play and would have made for a great.
Yeah, right. It's not that bloody good. It's crazy, it never ended up being an album, did it? It was being rubbish. But so give it, See, they're already.
It's
Some people say she's blind, but you know they're on the line. She's got it, oh yeah, yeah. Everything she says, everything she does, make you think I've got to be in her. La 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 in love. Every day of the week, ooh, she makes me weak. The reason she's got it, oh yeah, yeah. And the things she says, and the things she does, makes you think I've got to be in love. I'm not, in love. Thus she said she's mine. I try to keep on trying. Oh, if this smile, you keep falling in love with every shortest while. Not a chance. The parties are always smooth, and the smart boys say they will. She's got it. Says, and the things she does make you think you got to be in love.
with that, isn't it, Oscar? Fantastic. So tell us a little bit about the kind of your influences, because perhaps people coming to Ocean Colour Scene in the mid-90s would get a very mod impression of the band, particularly if it was channeled through Steve's view and influence. Yeah. But I think you come from a very different kind of set of tastes, I would say.
Yeah, Gregorian chant. Well, my sort of original name was the Beatles. I mean, anyone who's my mom, I'm 58 in May, in 25th. It's strange, actually, it's the same day as Paul, as well.
Paul Weller,
who's that's strange enough, whose mother's maiden name was Craddock. Yeah, Paul's exactly 30 years older than me. I came from the Beatles. I'm thinking the records that we had when we were children. First record I ever remember loving was a song by a band called the Avons, which was Seven Little Girls, Sit Me in the Back Seat, Hugging and a Kiss with Fred. Keep your eyes on your hands, keep your hands on the wheel, keep your snoopy eyes on the road ahead. We're having fun, sitting in the backseat, hugging and kissing with Fred. And I don't know what they're doing with Fred.
Wipe off American seats.
Yeah. You better come home, Speedy Gonzales. Those sort of things. But then basically our record collection was the Beatles on Parlophone and Simon Garfield on CBS had those records. So that's what I grew up with. And then, where were
you? I'm guessing the...
They're myriad, but I'm sure that, if you were into, Motown, classic music.
Really. But I think what I'm thinking of within your songwriting, then what really used to shine through was Neil Young, and David Bowie.
Neil Young, I got to know when I was 14, and that kind of changed my life, an album called Decade. And along there, Lou Reed, I think most people actually got to Velvet Underground via the love of David Bowie, who's another master for the, Joni mentioned Bob Dylan. I also thought Bob was probably in charge of all of them. I think he might have been the only person that John Lennon was scared of.
Richard, do you want to take this attitude?
All right, Uncle Bob. It's because no one's going to be scared of John Lennon, are they?
We shared a flat in Moseley on Blenheim Road, and Simon doesn't really...
remember a single day.
He's not one for possessions. He virtually owns nothing, really. And I only remember Simon having two possessions in the flat. One of them was a Gibson acoustic that would sometimes come out of your bedroom, sometimes not. And the other one was
sometimes on its own. If you just visited the wizard in St. Albany Road, just near the Trev.
Trevor. Somebody did actually write on social media.
£2.50.
Somebody did actually write to say, ask Simon, how come they took... How did I manage to take so many drugs and yet be so prolific?
Because I took them at 2 o'clock in the morning. Yeah, come the evening, it was absolutely great. Got pissed selling around there. Yeah. Well, no, we did enjoy ourselves.
Actually, most of the songs I used to write then, I used to write at home quietly in the night. And that was to Westfield Road, 52 Westfield Road in King's Heath. This when I remember writing one night, I wrote 50 Mind and
It's
My Shadow in one night. But when we used to share the flat, and Steve used to live above us, we used to get home, and it was always late, it was always after midnight, and probably been down the jug. And so you couldn't really go and put the Who on. So that's why we sort of fell in love with Fairport Convention, like a quiet album. And they're another band that they're coming change their life in Fairport.
Yeah, I mean, what's I think marks you out as a songwriter in amongst the crowd of songwriters who made it in the mid '90s is that you were very
old.
Well, you are older, but like no one was older than Liam in Oasis, and Jarvis Cocker was older. There was a lot of not young 20-year-olds, later 20s, and not early 30s, but you had a lot of you were very lyrical with a lot of. I don't know if a boast would be the right words, a lot of words in your lyrics, which is quite unusual for the sharp 3-minute songs that were kind of becoming very popular.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So like Fleeting Mind is a hell of a lot of long sentences, long words.
Yeah, I mean, I was into especially later writing, into those sorts of songs, but I mean,
is that because really you're stoned, so it puts you into a different way of thinking as a songwriter?
Right,
because
I'm a very good thriller.
That's not an ovation for that.
Yeah. Yeah. That's because also I seem to learn poetry. When you are 16, sort of like become very kind of like self-aware of if you like me really. William Burroughs and Bram Poet and Charles Bukowski and Dylan. Dylan is a complete and total magpie, really. I mean, that stuff, basically, that 60s stuff, it's the genius, it's all from the Illumination. Which was like in the 1880s, written by a 16-year-old called Arthur Amber. But it was in the star of that film.
Oh, with Sylvester Stallone.
And that kind of thing. So I mean, looking back at it, I was curious, I was like hopelessly pretentious.
And have you seen Arthur Amber 1, 2, and 3?
But I guess also because I knew that I was gay then, that I wonder if you wore, in them days, probably wore many cloaks. Yeah, maybe you did, maybe you wore many cloaks. Hoping that one of them would reveal something. Like an invisibility cloak.
To get all Harry Potter-esque. Play us another song, why don't you play us an American Way of Life?
Are you going to the bar? Can I have a premium lager? A nice head.
Milky bars are all new.
Someone cares.
Oh, I don't mind.
Get one for Danny, isn't it? Not since he's 13. I'm sick. In some woods, apparently.
Some ale would be great, thank you very much. Some ale. Yeah, he's still got Brew 11. Wait, what can you tell us about American Way of Life? Did you
sort that?
Did did you have a great desire to want to visit America? I mean, the band do go to America in the early 90s. Was that a dream come true?
I don't know, to be honest. We all grew up with American TV. I mean, I think that when I was a kid, because I read about this program the other day, they're going to remake it. Starsky and Hutch. Right, they're going to remake it with their daughters. I keep their daughters. And Starsky and Hutch was sent to prison.
But granted, did that come in?
Et cetera. I remember watching that as a kid, and I just thought it was fantastic. Really exciting. And so watching a $6 million man. $6 million. Who can you see your watch now? I don't know. I've not got this sort of link with America really. I'm actually not terribly sort of local.
So this is a kind of a sarcastic kind of look at what
it's very cynical way and an accurate way of just I think horribly that sort of slightly anti-American sentiment in this song was actually hasn't been proved right. Recent years. I'll do it as a pleasure.
I want to live the American way of life. I could live in a tent tomorrow. I could sail all night long. You say hello.
Good tune, right? I can remember it right.
As I say, if you want to hear Simon singing that as a 20-year-old, then there is a 7-inch single of that that comes with various versions of the book, and it's really fascinating to see Simon here now, obviously, and then how he was approaching and singing back then, and it's an incredible journey, and that journey obviously explodes for you at the end of 95 into 96, where having 8 years of really trying to make it with bands, from the Fanatics, the Ocean Colour Scene, making an album, it coming a bit late after a couple of front pages, and then the collapse of the band and interest in the music industry, you're suddenly launched into the forefront of the British music scene. Was it everything that you would imagined or hoped for when the first singles began to hit?
Well, that's what I remember. We were still in Benham Road, you and me, and I got a cab somewhere. It was on the radio, the cab driver's radio, and he mentioned Ocean Currency, and that suddenly we rocketed to sort of where success. Well, we were 7 years in the making. Hanging out a guy called, I don't know if you know this guy called, he was a drummer with Steve Gibbons.
Bob Lamb.
So he was down at Bob's for ages. We made the album with Jimmy Miller. I mean, that was an extraordinary.
He was the Rolling Stones producer for six albums.
Yeah, and also he produced the Ace of Spades. He produced Motorhead. I said, what were they like? I said,
they were goddamn assholes. After the goddamn album, they'd be turned around. That's just dealing speed. Great.
And he said something on the radio that was a bit like a car or something, accelerating or something. But I mean, it just literally sort of like that. When we did Moseley Shoals, it was originally going to be, is this a girl with me?
No. Taking a sniff left
there. So, it was going to be originally released on in Japan only. 15,000 released in Japan only on a company called Pony Canyon.
Yeah, which was going to happen with Wellen, wasn't it?
I think that Paul had sort of facilitated this for us. Anyway, it all fell through. And anyway, we didn't end up like that. It ended up on MCA, went to number two in the charts for 6 months and sold 1.3 million copies. Which was a real surprise. I mean, we had in the slightest. Really well. We thought it'd be like an underground, sort of like, I don't know. I don't know what we thought it was. I don't think we thought a lot of things were in a very linear line.
But I think a lot of bands were saying that, weren't they? Like Alan McGee signed Oasis thinking that they would be a kind of an undergroundish band. And I think that, you know, a lot of those bands that you'd expect in the 80s, like to be on the outside of the charts and not the mainstream, say the Smiths example, suddenly now in the 90s you were the big bands of the...
Well, it was down to releases. It was... It's just the going.
The privileges of selling 1.3 million records. Take the long way. You do canapes as well. What's your name?
Steve.
Welcome, Steve.
I'm a cook. No, just get it.
I'll give it to your mum. Hello, Beck.
Apparently, this used to have a special skin to the time.
Round of applause.
Of a hit single and hanging out with Chris Evans and who's
no.
In the show.
Yeah, so where were we? Yeah, we've got yeah,
so yes, was it something you embraced?
Just came around, but it was down to Chris Evans, really, the whole thing. It's just a it's a the whole tent.
That was like that thing that Tony Buckley used to play. You never go to school.
Go to school? I don't remember that.
Go to school in Moseley.
And I went to Villa Park. So let's get back to so we're at Moseley Shoals. It was basically Evans. Chris made us really. We'd had all that support, obviously, from Oasis and Paul. I mean, Paul was like that godfather, fifth Beatle. He made everything seem like we weren't just doing some like daft hobby. But without Chris, it wouldn't have happened. So, when you're at the record label, we did the pilot, the one before it goes out, of
TFI Friday.
TFI, and that went well. When it came out, said, "Would it be all right if I use Riverboat as our walk-on music, as like a feature movie?" Yes. So we did the first show. In fact, the following week, did the first show, and Riverboat went in at, I think, 15. Midwind was number 12, or two, actually, your school number is something. It was, for something I know, it was in our transit still, near Wembley, the Wembley Stadium, and Chris Craddock, who was our manager, Steve's father, he thought, us, are you sitting down? So we're in the van. Yes. The record's going midweek at 12. Oh my God, so we might be on Tour of the Pops, which we were in 15, actually, but get the album in at number 2, and we weren't expecting that in a month of Sundays, we really were, and it was really largely down to Chris Evans, who I'm proud to say is, I did his show a few months ago, and I love Chris Evans, and he loves me, and that's right. Thank you to Chris. I don't know if it's going to be on the you know, the fans and all that sort of nonsense. So Chris comes
I would recommend that if you haven't seen the interview that Simon did for Virgin Radio in December, played some acoustic tracks and you can find them online, and one of them was lots of you nodding, but he does he did a version of The River by Joni Mitchell, who used to play Blades of the Canyon and Blue by Joni Mitchell an awful lot in that period, didn't you? And you can feel the influence of that in the downstream, I would say, you know, say.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I got into Joni Mitchell, like, you get to Battlefield, apparently, so you got to the God of the Ground through Bowie. I got into Joni Mitchell through Neil Young, and wonderful.
Just give us a
Merry Christmas. Good night, trees. All the songs of joy and peace. I wish I had a river I could skate away from. I wish I had a river so long
at each pavement.
Because what it's reminding me of is what you alluded to earlier, which was when we were in the flat or the house together, that I'd often be in the room or hear you trying to write in the kind of way that you're singing at the moment. You just hear these kind of little nuggets of ideas, perhaps just a verse and a chorus as short as that, but even though that's not your song, obviously. And you'd hear these ideas in the early hours, and you could distinctly hear melodies, but they were very subdued kind of ideas and quiet because of the lateness of the night. And then to see that development as you went down to Bob Lamb's studio and you put Oscar and Dave and Steve.
You met the Stokes.
It was an incredible process. But one song that I'm really thrilled that you've agreed to play tonight, which will pretty much see us out to the interval, is one of the first songs I ever heard you play when I would have been 16, called 15 Minute Star. And it's an incredible song, and I don't think I've ever heard you sing it since those kind of days. And no,
I've never sung this song live.
Really? Literally never live? Wow. So none of the bands ever did it, Grape Child never did it, Fanatics, Ocean Plus, and yet, as you'll hear, it's a very Bowie influenced song, isn't it? And it has as I remember, it has a really wonderful uplifting mid-late, very typically of the kind of songs you write, you know, where they can be very melancholy verses, but you'll always, at some point, find the lift that takes you through.
I guess it is in my Bowie. 50 Minutes Star is obviously a reference to Andy Warhol, who volume in his days and his out, he nonsense, isn't he? As I was. So, we tried to do this when we did this show in London. Could not work out the bleeding chords from so I found out actually, strangely, they're in the book.
Can you sign it, please? Why would another beer?
Jumper.
Show all the doubles.
Guitar, maybe.
I've got some Trevor Francis underpants.
So get and give him pajamas. Let's swap.
You see, so this is yes. So I got this message from a manager. Dan had sent her the song, so he suggested that perhaps we could look at this evening. It was like 15 minutes Tom. Chords in book. I thought, I don't remember writing chords in book. I said, chords in book. And there were the original, writing the manuscript, I guess you call it. So that's what I did this week. I looked at it and thought, oh, yeah, darling. You know, I need two fingers for them. It's a very short song, actually. So. I heard the news today. Boy, run away.
couldn't bear to stay. And his life proved home. Christmases at your auntie just before she dies. I don't know.
So you're talking about a life that's just cosseted and protected, and you're, and so it's a kind of,
I think it's,
you're searching for freedom.
I think it's something you say when you're young.
Yeah, I think so. But that's the thing about lyricism, isn't it? That one or two lines or a short sentence can actually mean a massive things, and you can stray them into lyrics.
Yeah, your life proof home. I think it sounds to me like it was written by a spoiled brat.
Which isn't you, was it? As a kid.
I didn't write that song.
David Bowie
did. David did. Yeah, I don't know. It's, I think there is, when you're young, there's like, you've reached out for thoughts and things that are over there, and sometimes, and then you get a mortgage. Maybe you fall down and think, it's good to reach for the sun when you're a kid.
Yeah.
I thought
you were going to say reach the stars and you're going to go over Esther.
Do you know what? Actually, at one point I thought I was going to say that as well.
Maybe not. Anyway, I think we've been chatting for about about an hour now. So we're going to, in a moment, we're going to take a short interval so you can...
Or we're going to get pissed.
Yeah, buy Simon a drink, get a free book, that seems to be all good to go. And we'll reconvene. We'll reconvene.
Here's a tray.
I feel like a city here to be comic Eddie. But anyway, we'll reconvene. But we'll reconvene in quarter of an hour, and in the second half, do, if you have a question for Simon, do think of what you might want to ask him, an area you might like him to talk about. And then Simon's going to play some Osha Kulasin hits or classics. I'm not even sure what they're going to be yet. Yeah. So,
We're going to have a bit of a sing-along at the end of the evening,
haven't
we? So we're on a 15-minute break. I told my manager, she didn't understand this joke. I said that... I want a couple of drinks, you know, for when we have the half-time break. I said, that's what, you know, the football guy, when you move, change clubs. She said, do you want some water? And I want to be pulled off. Really? Anyway, the footman said, no, really, you can just get a couple of orange segments at
Come on, Ed, so we'll see you in 15 minutes. Welcome back to the second half. Simon just actually told me, he said, it'd be better when we go on stage if you don't drink. Honestly.
John actually never heard Daniel say.
Not a teddy bear. That's true.
Go on, sorry.
I could have just shot him and come out.
Oh, by the way, as we start, guys, look at this. This one got here. Birmingham pills.
It's horrible. Swap it for two, Madrew.
See that there?
Does the job.
So, you know, just after the pillar of being beaten 4-0 by the Blues. Let's face it, we don't play the same pleading league.
Sorry for me.
Drop it on someone's head. From the top of the halt.
Why are you a Leeds United fan?
Well, I wasn't a boy. When I went to my school, I changed schools when I was 9. Went from Acoustic Exchange Uni School, and I became at 6 for stealing name. From a back room.
And it was hard, isn't it?
Jesus Christ, I've got to tell you this. It's really weird. I was 7.
Eight.
So me and my pals, there was storerooms just over the end of the playground like that. And they got locked in. And my pals were, I was a little bit candy. That was the hardest. I was the only one that actually could probably string two sentences together, and one of them was a suspended sentence. they gifted me up. Quite like Starsky, didn't you? Flew straight to the door. Broke into the door. He went into his zipper. It was like lots of bags of cement and stuff on the floor. God knows. It must have been some work, but and with nails. So as boys thought, nails. So we were caught. And I was in the classroom, and suddenly there's a Simon Fowler. So he's put in front of the hole. It was especially a bit like this, really.
Quiet.
Especially all the kids in the classroom, they're all sitting on the floor in the we used sang prayers and hymns and stuff.
Assembly. Assembly.
Spanish assembly.
Assembly.
So Miss Leonard was our headmistress. I mean, I thought that she was
You can't remember most things.
Do you remember? I remember.
Miss Leonard.
Fucking remember. She stood us all up in the front of like this. In the front of the thing.
You see from Cairns.
And it was well nailed, so she went down the six of us. Peacock's from the six. God to me and he said, I feel like punching this stomach. Jesus Christ, you're on the front page of the current bun now. Where's that leading? So I've got this new ballad, Miss Leonard. Still, I'm going to say somebody else, so I'm not going to say it. It's a work in progress, so I'm not going to mention anything to do with them. I stop.
This isn't a night at Ken Livingstone. Yeah, Simon was notorious in his 20s for telling the same story multiple times. And as you were telling the story of being caned, I had visions and memories in my ear of Damon, that every time we drove past your old school, Damon would tell that story. Go so we pre
Or Damon was caned every fucking night of He was always claimed.
I just noticed your t-shirts. I've got Japanese tourists on the back. Oh my god. This gentleman here has got the old white t-shirt version cursing with rave. And on the back there's four dates, aren't there, Japan? Christ.
I got one
on there. So you're a fan of Sway.
Are they
just Sway, sir.
Are they the Quattro? Yep. So the Quattro on the back. Jesus Christ, that was brilliant.
It's a good time.
It was great the first time we were in Japan. Oh, Jesus Christ, we were treated like big hearts. So you play either at 6:30 or 7 o'clock at Quattro, which was on about the sixth floor in a shopping centre. And so you do the gig, and what's strange about it? So you get this round of applause here. Oh, quickly, change the guitar. So by about 8 o'clock, we were off stage. So what should we do tonight? Should we go out? That's great. I'd love for my band to be able to play matinees. Brilliant, wouldn't it? Matinees.
In a minute, we're going to take some questions. But one final thing I want to ask you is, is it you were in Japan for the video of Profit and Peace and Simon Scared of Heights? And aren't you on?
So was Oscar.
Oh, Oscar's as well.
Yeah.
And aren't you on? Impossibly high building.
We're doing this. We're staying in this hotel, which is 46 stories high, or something. And I said, so anyway, we're going onto the roof. So you can just sort of sit by the side of the building. 800 foot down. No. So if you look at the video,
I'm absolutely sure that Stephen Damon, there, I think that me and Oscar sort of found some place far near. Well, I'm the singer. I'll be in the front row. I'll be in the front row. Absolutely petrified. I mean, now if that had happened, that wouldn't have happened. And just as we started filming, these helicopters started flying over. Like we'd hired them for the video. We hadn't actually. This was quite a lot.
Yeah.
But petrified.
Should we raise the lights?
No, I've only just, I lived in a bungalow that last 25 years, or two bungalows. And Rob and I were just building.
Is that intentional so you don't have to look out? Oh, because when we, I have to say this, that we, when we wrote the book that's now gone to our
heaven. This book has gone to heaven. I was all with you. I saw them up on Broad Street, what used to be called Burberry's. Burberry's, and then became Ronnie Scott's, and then became a strip joint. Well, I saw Burberry's, the Pixies. And they're supporting a band called the Throne Muses. Do you remember them? Exactly. Do you remember the Pixies? I thought, Jesus Christ, I wouldn't want to be in the Throne Muses after that. So probably one of the best gigs I've ever seen in my life, the Pixies, Bat Francis, you know, that Smokey's gone to him. They're an incredible band. And what's great about it for me is that all the front row were teenage boys, and because it was so late. It was so hot. Sorry, they all taking their shirts off. I love the boxes. Now they're great, weren't they? Pixies. No one remembers the Throne Muses, though, do they?
So, if you have a question that you'd like to ask Simon, do raise your hand. And I'm always aware at these events that the guys always get to ask the questions first. So, is there a lady or woman that would like to ask a question to Simon? Really? No. Well, would you just wait 1 second because we have microphones? Would you, there's a front row here, if you don't mind. Thank you.
I saw my guy over here, Chris, at the first Birmingham, was that bloke with the yellow hat on.
Do keep raising your hands, because then I'll know where to come to next. Okay, thank you. So,
sorry, you mentioned, you do some good impressions on the stage, very good impressions. I just wondered if you were like that school, you like a sort of joke,
I'm not sure the microphone's on if you can hear at the back, but you're asking if someone can do impressions. Were you the class joker at school?
Yes. Yes. I mean, I get this from my dad, really. I'm incredibly like my dad, apart from he doesn't drink. He's never done drugs, and he's straight. Apart from that. Yeah, no, I'm not for that, yeah. My first hero really was Frank Spencer. And there's always a resistance. just to do people's voices and stuff. I guess it was a way of making people laugh, and I've always enjoyed that enormously. And to be quite honest, I think I've been in impersonations probably for the last 30 years. Yeah, we've talked about, David Bowie,
I remember one saying to me, I can do Macca, and you just learn how to do it, and suddenly you could do his voice.
That's what you said, kind of do, before everyone used to spend their entire lives
doing this. Scale entrance. So that's a lady just here, just there. Do raise your hands again for me.
I heard that you don't really like your first album, Lodge the Live Life. Does he think it's brilliant?
I didn't catch that, did you?
Shout!
Yeah, sorry.
Should you speak right into the mic?
Yeah. I heard that you don't really like your first album, and I just wondered why. Because you think it's brilliant?
Right, really? I can't remember it. There are some nice songs in there. I thought that was a strange situation. Jesus Christ. I mean, we recorded that. We started recording on the set with a guy called Jimmy Miller, who was the guy who basically changed the Stones from, like, the Beatles understudies in 67 to the band which they became, which was that classic row of albums, which was... Fingers Penguin and Bleed, Exile, Sticky Fingers. And we went up to go to Sue, which
was massively influenced by Mick Jagger's voice on that period, remember that song?
No. But so he started off doing that, and it went wrong because basically Jimmy was a recovering alcoholic. Actually, he was an alcoholic, and his wife was dying of cancer at the time out in the States. So he used to turn up with her he got the sack and I had to pick Jimmy up from the East Street Station, my Beagle. He wanted to borrow a grand from me. He said, "Hey, what do the guys think about the recordings?" He said, "Michael, in fact, I don't need to work with this man." He started crying. The guy whose name is on there, is in one Beggar's Banquet, the white version. And Jimmy's name is written like in female italics, like the bottom of his name. Oh, Jesus Christ. So we went to a place in Spark Hill. It was called American Express. They wanted to transfer money because it was banking out from the States. Opposite there was a building called the Antelope. It is now, it's still got the Antelope sign in there, but it's now an Indian restaurant. So I went into Jimmy, with Jimmy into the boozer. It was about 11:30, so it was me and Jimmy, the Rolling Stones producer, a few Asian guys, a few Irish guys, broken down, drinking. I thought, Jesus Christ. No one is ever going to tell me what's right in the corner. Because I never thought that I'd be sitting in the tuning room.
In the spot at 11:30 in the morning.
Yeah. I had a coffee.
Steve doesn't recognise the first album, does he? He always says the first album is Moseley Shoals. And you, I remember you saying at the time that the album might as well have been sponsored by Reverb.
Well, I think they just passed the time. I mean, if someone said to me what the first album, I can't see. I don't know if it's a short album. Because we have like great times before that. I mean, does anyone have a song called Sway?
Yeah.
Well, that was kind of our first signature tune. We used to play a place in Bedford called Squires. And there's a band actually called the K's who supported us there, and that was, they became Corner Shaker. And so it's like, '91? That's what time. And so I saw that on our set there's Swells and Best of Song, track number four. So everyone's got an ape, and downstairs they've got a whist drive for local Bedford pensions.
So the guy in front of the club comes up to me and says, the paint, they're all falling off the roof onto them playing cards. So, Christ. So we did sway and we were never invited back.
Question for the gentleman there, I think, in the leather jacket.
Evening, Simon.
Hello. Wait, I come to you.
Was You Got It Bad single, and there's a B-side for that. It was called I Want to Stay Alive With You, and it was that lyric. 13-year-old girls want to stay on the other side of the world, but it doesn't mean that. That always struck a chord with me, that did. Being a young lot, 15, 16-year-old, like, always wonder where that come from.
Well, two
reasons. And other sides of the world.
Yeah, I'll tell you where it came from. I actually saw a TV program. It was a documentary about basically exploitation of kids in Thailand. I think that it's as prosaic as that really are. So, yeah. It was a lot of things when you see, I see things, and I'm an avid reader of newspapers and listening to radio and things going there, and they can't stay in there. And then they come out months later. So almost, well, not verbatim, but I turn them into what I think is the word verbatim of that, without a truth.
Okay,
it is a lovely song.
Thank you. I love that tune.
Gentlemen in the blue cap.
Yes, sir. How you doing? Sorry.
Brent for the squad.
Right. We slightly touched on Steve earlier and how you met, but I think I'd quite like to know that relationship, how it started and how it grew, and how yourself and Steve wrote so many fantastic songs, and even to this day, how important maybe he's been as part of the songwriting partnership.
Okay, right. I met Steve I can't remember the first time I met him, to be honest.
He was playing in Deadland, wasn't he?
No, I know what it was. I was at these woods. I can't actually remember.
0898.
But basically,
it was in Deadland, wasn't it? The late band.
Deadland. It was all in local bands. So it must have been something like that. I'll say that Birmingham was a very small parish almost when we started off in terms of musicality, and Solihull was kind of just up the road. So I got to know Steve, probably it must have been from seeing him. And his dad was a very forceful and charismatic character. He became Ocean Colour Scene's manager for a long time. And he wanted me and Steve to get together. And I was always very loyal to my band, the Fanatics. And I can't remember what decision I made, but basically I thought, right, I want Steve and the band. Damon didn't want to sleep with them because they had got this daft rivalry, because they were more like the same similar age. When you're that age. So I told them, I said, so we went around to Steve's house in Downs Wood, just near the Rover. And Steve had gone away to he's 4 years younger than me. And he'd gone down to decorate a house with his uncle and taken a guitar down with him, and he learned how to play Hey Joe, the Hendrix version of it. So went down to his garage, and so he started playing Hey Joe, I said, you're in. Because he was a bass player,
Steve was never a guitar player, he was a bass player when he joined the band. He's probably still the best bass player in, probably in England. And so he bought sort of the mob sensibility, which everyone always thinks we are. I've never been asked, well, you can see. I've never been asked to be a mod. This is too much hard work. But the thing is that the funny thing is about that mod axis is that you get the small faces. I mean, the small faces are the archetypal mod band. I mean, the Who, everyone said that, the Who basically were told to be mods, really. But the small faces, Jesus Christ. I mean, there is, if you say mod is Motown, there's someone between Motown and Zeppelin. And you see Steve Marriott, and they're doing like some of their songs were some of their rock songs. They're as close to Zeppelin as to Motown. And also they've got the folk element here. So I think that the small faces were very, very important thing where we saw each other's thing. And then I would say that after that, and of course then Stephen Damon also, the Lars album came out before all of the other albums came out. The Lars album. And then obviously the Rose's album came out. And that sort of gave us that kind of thing where all of our musical passions and love seemed to suddenly meet, and Steve was very much involved with that. And Steve has always been basically the musical director of Ocean Crossing, because I'm not a musician, I'm a strummer. And I can play a bit of harmonica. It's my next book, actually, it's my autobiography. I'll base it on my harmonica, it's called Suck, Blow, and Hope.
I must say, there's just to draw your attention, if you do want to look at Simon's book, this is an amazing poster, and the poster is a three bill, and it's Transaction, Deadline, and The Great Betrayal, and translated into Ocean Colour Scene speak, that's Damon's band, Steve's band, Simon's band, and the three bands played on quite a few bills together in the mid to late 80s.
Can you remember where what's that poster from?
Mermaid.
The Mermaid?
And the barrel organ, it's like...
Jesus Christ, remember the Mermaid? Fuck me, I remember we played the Mermaid. Go to stage, there was a fucking dog shit on there. There was old-fashioned urinals, right, which we'd known politicians like the old-fashioned thing, full of vomit.
Another nice outing, bro. Anyone else would like, where's the question coming from? Right down the front here if we can, please, and then I'll come to you after.
So I can't tell you anything with him.
Hi Simon, is there anything you can say about the stuff you're doing with Steve at the moment? I know you've been doing demos and stuff with him. Are you going to be zipped about that?
I've been down, I was down with Steve last week, and he's got a place down in Devon, his home, and he's got this most amazing studio. I should have counted the guitars, but I can only count, basically, I'm numerically almost dyslexic. I can count in quarters, eighths, sixteenths. I mean, he must have 50 instruments, 50 guitars, like 12 string, 6 string, acoustics, electrics, bass, Hammond organ there, Wurlitzer.
The electric piano. And did you record new songs?
Yeah, we recorded 5 new songs.
Woo! Why is that taking 10 years to get to?
because I'm a lazy fucker. Music, you have the arts.
and the photographs of all the people. I read a lovely review yesterday in one of the Quality Nationals, and it was of Pat Arnold, who obviously we've worked with, and she played at the jazz cafe with Steve's. Steve's like their band, and got a lovely review, and I got a great sort of well of pride from that, because that was a lovely story. Pat coming and playing with us, and she's got some amazing stories for you to tell you. You told me you was going to get one for me.
It's kind of hot.
You get one free. Just give me to that. I know all the Beatles songs, eh? Taxi. The first time I met the Ike. The first record she did was singing on Taxi. Ike used to run his round backstage as I guess he got the biggest cock I'd ever seen in my life.
Sure, that's okay. There's a question right there.
Hi, Simon, I'm Val.
Val. I sort of said Bab was saying I'm from
firstly, thank you for the music, Simon. So I'm going to take you back to 1996, and this was my first ever gig. I was 15 then, and I just wanted to take you back because I was absolutely amazed. First time I saw you, you're back at the Aston Villa Leisure Centre.
Oh, I think I was there as well.
And,
yeah, I think I was probably the same age as you.
And I'm 42 now.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
I don't know what that is. Is it like Grindr?
So, I'll never forget when you sung Line in Your Pockets and It's My Shadow. And firstly, do you remember this gig?
I do remember that gig. I'll tell you why, because is that the gig that Roy Wood?
Yeah.
Sang with us, yeah.
Yeah, Paul Weller was there with the bootleg Beatles and you all came on at the end.
What?
Yeah,
you
all came on at the end. I'm putting it on here.
Ambulance, ambulance. Susan?
Sorry, I'm a ticket because I was so amazed.
What, on the same bill?
Yeah, that's because you're a special guest. I think you came out on the end or something. Yeah,
you did Blackberry White.
Jesus Christ, I had such a good time when I lived in Moseley in those years, isn't it? I must have spent so much money to not remember. Bootleg Beatles and Wellers.
For a 15-year-old, my first gig, Ocean Colour Scene, and your voice blew me away. And then, well, Weller, I'm the Bootleg Beatles. And I was like, oh, I mean, I don't take drugs, but I think that's fantastic to your mum. And even now, you keep me up and
I can't. I actually don't believe you. I think you do take drugs. I love the natural world.
You like the perfect back. I work with the Sanctuary.
Yeah.
And I said, we need Simon to come down.
Where is it?
We thought Animal Sanctuary on Middle Lane. We rescue with them animals.
I've got a dog.
You're actually keen or you like birds, don't you?
Birds, yeah.
So you like the perfect man, guys?
Yeah.
When I was a kid, I was very much into ornithology and all that sort of stuff. I was fascinated by that. But I got a dog. He's a cocker bull called Cool.
He's
been asked a question by Oscar. Of course, the Oscar's behind the microphone. So
stop shouting!
We'll pass it up to him, so Oscar can ask it if he wants to. Get Oscar to ask it. Pass the mic back. Pass it back. Pass the mic behind you.
Simon.
No, go on.
Why are you banging from the bell? I live in the village next door, mate. I'll go there tomorrow on 40th birthday, and I'm just wondering, why are you banging from the bell? Oscar.
It's true, isn't it, Oscar?
We start the four rules.
I'm not banned from the bell.
I didn't think you were, but he said you are.
Yeah, well, he's
Oscar, you're safe. You can come back
in.
He's often very, very confused.
I have been in many pubs where the landlord or landladies come up to me and said, can you tell your friend that he's not allowed any more drinks? many times. So we have another question. Bunch of guys. It's all guys. No ocean cover scene fans are probably 70% men. That's you've already asked the question.
Hello.
Yes. I was looking for someone of the opposite sex, just to keep it fair.
Opposite sex, that's a question, isn't it, now? Daniel, I think that you should all announce
of a different sex.
They are on their own.
Go on, Ed, at the back room.
Do I have to say anything in a female voice?
Sorry?
Do I have to say anything in a female voice?
No. Are you kidding?
I just want to ask you about the song Get Blown Away. That would be one of my favourite ever Ocean Christian songs. There's a lot of lyrics, there's a lot of words and a lot of verses, and I just wondered where that came from and what the history was.
Well, then, before you answer something, let me just remind you, when we were trying to find original handwritten lyrics
from
the time for this book, you found a couple of pages, and it's quite unusual for you. You'd written out three or four different versions of the song, and the first version was called Houses and Homes, not Get Blown Away.
Yeah, it was called Houses and Homes. It's totally about my boyhood and holidays in basically Sandbanks, which is now one of the wealthiest places on earth. See Bournemouth. We used to go down there as our family, but there'd be like nine of us with all the older. That's how we lived, really, with our grandparents and cousins. And it was blissful to me, my childhood. An extremely fortunate. It's on the beach. They go back, and mum and aunt make the dinner. Housewives used to do in their old days.
So they must have just covered sand. Is that sand?
Yeah. So it's all about that.
What about the smoke across the room?
Oh, that's imagination. That's bringing in a story into. The basis of it was my incredibly happy childhood, and I guess it's maybe a tribute maybe to my family and my parents in particular. But then you start off the thing here, and you don't know as a source, you don't know where it comes from. It's like an aerial, and sometimes it works. And where the hell did that come from? I've got no idea. I'm absolutely convinced.
that if you just learn a few chords on the guitar and you sit down and start singing, well, these things come to you. I suppose you want them to come to you, but to actually do it well, you have to do it a lot, you know, which is what I've done by that point. And they're great, those lyrics, aren't they? I think it is probably one of the best songs I think I've ever written.
Do you think a song is in some way pre-written when you start writing it, you're trying to find the thing that fits?
I don't know.
Because there's something going on.
I don't know. It's almost like describing a dream or something like that. I mean, I'm going to get balls everywhere. Do you know what I dreamt
about last night?
Tell us about the last trip you had. Another question before we get to the point. There's lots of questions. I'm not sure how many more we should take before you play some tunes.
Oh,
could you bring the mic to this gentleman here?
I'm not playing anything.
I want £500
on this table now. Be here for Birmingham. Czechoslovakian. You see that? I love this. Birmingham Pilsner. Do they have written Pilsner?
Just speak.
I know it was before that, did you end up making up with this band and did you all become friends again, or was it really a sore subject?
No, really. I'd love to meet Damon again, really. He did something on YouTube the other week, didn't he?
Yeah.
Not great. But, I cried my eyes out on the train back to my brother's house in, I went from that night to this sister's in Brum. I got on the train, went to Bromsgrove on my older brothers, and I cried all the way back because I see people looking at me on the train. So, yeah, the sad thing that was, with the Musketeers. I don't know who was D'Artagnan. But anyway, he's a great bass player, and he's been doing well with Richard.
Gentlemen here.
Yes, I've been asking to know if you had favourite Beatles album or Beatles song. As hard as that is, I know it's a tricky question. I've always wanted to ask you.
It changes every time. Every time I listened to Sgt. Pepper all the way through the other night. I've never done that for years and years. My favourite Beatles album is the White Album. Because well, number one, number nine. It's two albums. So no, I love that. I remember when I actually heard that. My older brother Nicholas, he played with me. I thought, well, it doesn't sound like Beatles to me. I'd have probably been. Maybe 11 or 12 or something. It was some of the Beatles to me. And now, of course, as an adult, that's what I love about it. It is like the whole of the world. I love it. And also, it sounds like the guys playing together as a gang.
An Ocean Colour Scene, before Moseley Shoals, brief period, covered While My Guitar Gently Weeps Live. Do you know that?
No.
There's video footage at City Tower. Let's have a couple more questions and then we'll have some tunes. Lady, third row from the back. Two.
Just a quickie. So whenever we get together as a group...
Just a quickie, that'll do.
So when we get together as a group, we're listening to Ocean Colour City, we quite often say, musically, lyrically, we think the streets ahead of bands like Oasis, Blur, of the time. So I just wondered why you didn't make it as commercially big, and does that frustrate you? You know, is there anything that you feel like that because you should have? Do you know what I mean?
I don't know, really. I mean, the press hated us, didn't they? When we started off, I mean, Oasis basically kicked open the doors for bands like us, and because we used to be in interviews and say like the Beatles do, like an accusation. Oh, yes, yes, but we like the band. New Rose, 1976, first punk song. And they told me, fuck you, mate, fuck you, Beatles. Kicked open the doors, and suddenly the Beatles were cool. Well, I've been saying that since I was, you know, like, fuck you, mate, fuck. The press hated us.
Why?
Frankly.
Who's you? Good.
Well, not so much me, but. Oscar and I were on the green side of the band. I think the white side of the band maybe annoyed some journalists as well. Maybe that was something to do with it. They didn't like us, they thought it was dad rock and all that sort of shit, and then Oasis came on. But Oasis is saying, oh, this is a little bit. To discuss, you know, who's the best at this record. The best frontman of our generation was Liam. And he kicked open the fucking doors, and also, what a great night out he is. You must remember it was Nolan, Liam, my band, and it was us versus the world. Blah. It was a good band as well, but I don't know. They just didn't like us. But I think we did all right. You all right, you know? We're number one. I mean, I'm getting up to number one. Yeah.
Simon.
Have you heard the Oasis now? They're reforming. They're doing cruise ships.
Jay McDonald.
What about Ian Brown from the Stone Roses?
What about him?
Champion Blood.
We saw the Stone Roses, didn't we, at the Irish Centre, 1989.
Yeah.
Me, you and Damon went, and Steve went on his own separately. And then you all went to Spike Island. You did all four of you?
Yes, we went to Spike Island. You know, my school pal mine, the Ranger and Fisher. And we nearly all died. He was in the fast lane, and I did my driving awareness courses.
Attention.
2.5 hours watching the pretend television. I was in the overtaking lane, not fast lane. I thought that his steering column had gone. I didn't know what was going to happen. Actually, what happened? He got a flat tyre. He pulled over to the hard tyre, but it ended up in a Spike Island. What a horrible gig that was. That classic gig, horrible. We were about an hour and a half late on stage. There was one, shack selling beer. I don't know what it was, but I think the wind must have been going on, but the
what I do remember you telling me, Simon, was that there was a gig, and you have to refresh my memory on this, I think the band were going to play in Cardiff, and you were going to cover She Bangs the Drum.
Oh, yeah.
As a band, you start rehearsing it.
Yeah. You're a nice one. It's lovely, sweet. It's just after Damon left the band, actually. And CB Server House, do you know, as you go past what's called the Botanical Gardens, right? So you're, then you're around the corner, you've got the White Swan, like you know, that's a dirty dirt. Well, Steve's house was the first one going up to Harborne Hill on the same side, on the left hand side as the Dirty Duck. So anyway, so Manny from the Roses comes down and he's going to play bass with us at the, it's not the Prince, is it? Principality Stadium. He may have been just built there. It wasn't Cardiff, oh, maybe it was Cardiff Half Life. No, it was Principality. And we're supporting the Australian Phonics. What a, the nicest bloke in the world in music I've ever met is Manny from the Roses. So we're starting right there, like midnight, like we're seeing who could be the best Mick Jagger. Steve's room, like, doing like this. Probably this guy from the Roses, who I thought was going to be like, I am the great What a great guy he was. Fucking fantastic, Manny. Lovely, voice. And yeah, we ended up playing in Cardiff at the great big stadium. Now, also in the band at the time was is my brother-in-law actually, Dan Seeley. Do you remember Dan playing with the band? Well, his wife, Julia, was in love with the singer from
Kenny Jones.
Kenny, yeah. So she was on the side of the stage, so I watched this, and she says, can I have a photograph with you? Do you know why I did that? My wife's in love with him. I just had that photograph because I'm about a foot taller.
I think we've got a final question there, haven't we?
I love Huckleberry Grove. Sorry, I'm speaking so loud. Are Shirley and Huckleberry Grove real or are they inventions?
No, it's the whole story is true. It was a friend of Oscar's. And she came down, she'd be probably in her 60s, I think, Shirley. She came to our studio, just near Five Ways. And we had a lovely afternoon there. And she did have 8 children. And she did have golden teeth. So I just wrote it basically from meeting her. Huckleberry Grove is obviously from Huckleberry Finn. But it's actually for a Johnny Mercer song, which is My Huckleberry Friend. What's the song called? Moon River. It's from Moon River, yeah. I just thought, Huckleberry Grove, Huckleberry Friend. I think Moon River, that's one of the greatest lines ever written in music. He's a black guy, Johnny Mercer, who wrote that song. And I don't think any of his songs were published until he died.
And a sensational trombone solo.
Yeah, from Rico Rodriguez. I listened to this and I've seen me. Jesus Christ. I was just thinking, we could sit here for hours and talk about it when Rico and Pat Arnold were on tour with us. Jesus Christ, but I won't.
Okay, Simon, so if you get your guitar ready, we're going to round off the night with Simon playing it.
Shall we play some tunes, you know?
Yay!
You enjoyed it.
Before Simon does all this, I just thank you all very much for coming and being the fortunate 216, I think it is, that got tickets. I don't know many more than wants to.
The camera.
I'll tell you now, because we're going to Ireland. The fifth day to this tour. But if you've enjoyed listening to Simon's stories, and then I say that if you don't own the book already, the book is in the form of 69 of Simon's songs and lyrics, and each song is a conversation between Simon and myself, where he discusses the genesis of the song, the lyrical ideas, what the band do to it, but also, and I think Simon's never really done this before, as you realise tonight, he uses it as a tripping device and go in to tell his stories about perhaps his childhood, his family, friends, moments in his life. And what emerges from this book is a very unique impression of who Simon is, and you get lots of different sides of him that perhaps you wouldn't have known about before. What you might not realise is what makes up his personality. There's plenty about Ocean Colour and plenty about Oscar and Damon and Steve, but also lots of areas that I think are really interesting and fascinating, because it reflects my friend that is fascinating and interesting and always has a story to tell you. And it's a wonderful thing to just dive into it and enjoy some stories. And now that you've heard the tone of his voice and the way he tells jokes and stories, hopefully you'll carry that through into the reading of the book. So I hope you'll perhaps buy it and enjoy it. But more importantly, from Ocean Colour Scene, one of the great bands of the 90s, me mate, Simon.
He's my oldest mate, really. I've known Dan since he was five. So a nice one for Daniel. And without him, this book wouldn't have been done. So, oh my God, what should we have? We have some hits.
Yes.
Dublin's
Robin Hood.
Robin
Hood.
Robin
Hood.
You're Robin Hood.
Yeah!
Yeah. Travellers!
So low!
No, I never knew you! Both went to different schools. Mrs. Skill rules. She's now the girl. Get up and dance. Get up and smile. get up and drink to the ones who are gone in the shoeless way. I sing my sorrow. Sing my sorrow. Sing my sorrow. Sing my sorrow. Can I just say, it's the sound clean. Can you just turn my guitar down a fraction? Right, just sort of. Yeah? Is that possible up there? I don't know. Yeah, yeah, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. A bit more up, bit more up, bit more up, bit more up. A bit more up. Almost.
But no.
When you start to choke, take some pills for your coke, it's inspiration. When your life is a mess, light one more cigarette, it's so logical. With something your brother can't abide, but it's something that I freely prescribe. Take yourselves for a ride, you never felt so good as the night that you and I made.
Thank you.
Strange what he, strange ever, I thought it was my Labrador.
Rapping on the window.
Rapping on the window. Until that Labrador's signing up. It's just a change of heart. Rapping on the windows, whistling down the chimney pipes. Blowing off the dust in the room where I forgot. I leave a man in some solid rubbish. I'm slipping through the door like a juggernaut. Why just an hour away? Looking at the trees on the roadside, thinking it's a bright day. Say, you and I should ride the coast and wind up in our favorite coast, just miles away. Say, rolling number, riding down the sunlight, give me a
thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Simon Fowler. Thank you very much for coming to the dark side of the crowd and start talking to you.